Hey everyone, this is Michael Drain from the Unpopular Culture Podcast. You are listening to the BS Podcast Network. Hope you enjoy the show.
Who are you?
I'm Batman.
Who are you?
My name is
Bond.
I'm Batman.
Name is Bond.
James Bond.
I am Batman.
Bond.
James Bond. I'm Batman.
Bond.
This is the Batman vs. James Bond show. The show covering everything related to Batman and James Bond movies. And now, here's your host, Brian Thomas.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to an all-new episode of the Batman vs. James Bond show. The name's Thomas, Brian Thomas, and I am your host. And this is a show where we discuss everything related to Batman and James Bond movies. It's great to be back. And joining me this week is, I would say, a good friend of the show, Mr. Christian Evangelista. What's going on, buddy?
Hey, not too much.
Hey. I didn't know how to introduce you. It's like, well, good friend of the show. Yeah, I mean, you are a good friend of the show. You've been on,
you've been on,
I can't think about how many times. I'd say at least three. This is going to be your fourth.
This is the fourth time, yeah.
Yeah, this is the fourth time, yeah.
I think, was that actually your first? No. You had an interview, but I'm trying to think, I'm the first like listener who typed in and said, hey, I want to be on the show.
Yeah, it's like, hey, come on. Yeah, absolutely, yes. No, I love having you on the show, absolutely. And as a matter of fact, quick behind the scenes thing is that, you know, when Christian, he reached out to me, letting me know, and we're going to talk about it in the body of the show, that he was going on a trip. And I'm like, you know, I wanted to have you on. It was like not even a week before. I'm like, man, I want to have him on before the end of the year because, believe it or not, we are only, it's what, 3 weeks till New Year's, give or take, right now?
Something like that, yeah.
Something like that. I don't even know how many Christmas days of shopping there are left, but I finished mine. I'm not sure about you, but I'm pretty simple. Give me something with Batman. Give me something James Bond related, and I am happy as a pig in mud. I'll tell you. Anyway, I hope everybody's had a fantastic week. Mine was great. Nice, relaxing week. And I would say that I was watching more James Bond, but it was actually more Batman and Star Wars movies. And yeah, guilty as charged, if you want to say. Yeah, I think we're all feeling the Star Wars fever around here. I'll touch on that a little bit in the show also, because everything can be related to Batman and James Bond, even Star Wars. So, just a reminder that BatmanVsBond.com is up. That's right, BatmanVsBond.com is up. It's my official website. You can find all the latest episodes on there. As a matter of fact, you can find all of the older episodes on there. I will warn you that some of those older episodes, sometimes things should be locked up in the vault. I will compare them to the Batman and Robin, you know, movie in a way. It's like, it's there. I'll mention it. But it's like the back card. Don't leave home without it. Well, sometimes we can leave home without this, but there are some good episodes, believe me. I'm not knocking my show at all. But I will say, as the show has gone on, I would definitely say it's improved. So you can also find the Batman vs. James Bond show on the BS Podcast Network. That's BSPodcastNetwork.com. Find my show and a whole bunch of other great shows on there. So, Christian, let's get down to business. I was telling you right before the show, there's a lot of news that's been dropping in this last week. I'm like, I'm not ready for this. I can't believe. Why is it that everybody's dropping all this news? It's like, it's Christmas season, damn it. I mean, just relax. Let's just, you know, enjoy some Batman and Batman Returns. Let's go watch Honor Majesty's Secret Service for the umpteenth time, you know? I mean, I don't know. But it's the first bit of news here is that Aquaman has been delayed. So what does that mean for us as Batman fans? Well, it means the WB has pushed back the release of Aquaman back to October 5th, 2018. But there was actually a movie tentatively called The Batman, which was Ben Affleck's solo Batman movie, that was originally scheduled for that time. Now, there's a good chance that The Batman could be pushed to July 27th, 2018. Ooh. I'm really excited about this because I don't know if I want to say superstitious, but the last two Batmans that came out in July were a little movie called The Dark Knight by Christopher Nolan in 2008 and The Dark Knight Rises in 2012. So
that's right. Yeah.
I'm going to put two and two together here and say maybe this is what I think this is. What do you think, Christian?
I mean, I'm trying to think what else Warner Brothers might have on their schedule that would potentially fit in for that date, and something that they would move Aquaman, like, just especially since, you know, all the buzz coming off of Jason Momoa and Aquaman has always been really, surprisingly, given, you know, Aquaman's history, has been really positive. So the fact that they're moving it back makes me think it's got to be something big, say, you know, with a pointy bat ears.
I'm thinking that too, and you know, a nice little thing called the Batmobile, you know, a couple batarangs in there. Well, get this. This just dropped not even yesterday, I think it was. Mm-hmm. It turns out that according to the Hollywood Reporter that Zack Snyder has they push back Justice League 2 to make room for Ben Affleck's Batman movie. So Justice League 2, it's still going to be directed by Zack Snyder. I think that's it was always in talks. I don't know if this is official now that, you know, now Zack Snyder is attached to Justice League 2. I would say it depends on the reception of Justice League. I know that I'm praying that this movie will be really, really good. I think we all want a really good Justice League movie. I mean, I don't think... All right, yeah, there's people out there that want it to fail, some people on another team. That's cool. Or just some people that like bashing... WB and Batman movies, who knows, DC Comics, I have no idea. That's on them. It is, you're a fan of what you are, no big deal. But for us to get this Batman movie even sooner, and I'm really excited about this now. I've talked about this before that, you know, having a solo Batman movie, I wish we would have had it like this year. I mean, before the Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice. And I've watched that now that it's on HBO. I've just been watching that over and over. I kept coming in on the same parts of it, of course, when, you know, Batman's setting up the kryptonite and he's getting ready to fight Superman. Spoiler alert there. That's what the movie is called. But, you know, when I watched that movie, I always ask you this probably when you're on the show, but what was your overall picture or what was your overall rating of, did you get to see the ultimate cut?
I did see the ultimate cut. Okay. I think I'm trying to remember when I saw it. Maybe about a month after that it came out on Blu-ray. I got it. I pre-ordered it, but I finally like actually buckled down to sit down and watch it. I think about a month after that, I got it. And I will say, the ultimate cut made it make so much more sense.
Didn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, but if you didn't like the movie in the first place, you're still not going to like it not going to like it if you watch the ultimate cut. But
agreed.
If you were sort of on the borderline of liking it and not liking it with the ultimate cut, it'll push you over that borderline. I mean, one of the big things for me was the fact that, all right, you know, Superman, why did they think in the theatrical cut, why did they think that Superman killed all those people? They were shot by bullets.
Right.
And then, but the ultimate cut goes on to explain what they burned the bodies and did other stuff to make it actually look like Superman killed them. Mm-hmm. So it's like, all right, that's one, you know, one of many small things is like, really, you should have just left that in the movie.
Yeah, there were things that could have been cut out of just the theatrical version. That's the one that they're showing on cable right now. You know, when I went back and watched that, I'm like, oh, it feels different because I'm like, now I'm used to things being organized a different way. You move a couple scenes, you explain a few things, you explain that Superman, you know, that he was really being set up, and more specifically, why he was being set up by Lex Luthor. Lois Lane getting to investigate more of Batman. Didn't need to see the shower scene, of course, with Batman. But hey, you know, hats off to Ben Affleck for being in incredible shape for his age. You know, I think that, you know, overall though, if we that movie could have been, I've said it many times, that movie could have been just, we could have had a set up Batman movie before we had that. We could have even had a Man of Steel 2 before we had that, seeing Superman more, you know, being Superman. And this, it was too much too fast. Yes, absolutely,
exactly.
So yeah. I'm always curious what this new Batman movie, the solo movie, could be, because I'm going back, I'm watching Batman Returns, and I'm thinking about it even today. I'm like, you know what, It wasn't the most complicated premise. You introduce Catwoman, you see her origin story, you see the origin story of the Penguin, and you have Batman being Batman. And yeah, they're trying to make him look like he's corrupt in a way, and you know, trying to turn the tables on him, but it wasn't anything like how they're doing it now. And I guess that's why I still have love for those movies, because you're not trying, it doesn't have to be the shared universe, but it's just throwing too much in one movie at one time.
I think, and this may be controversial because this is a Batman podcast, but okay. I'm a huge fan. I think I've told you that, you know, I'm a huge fan of the Marvel movies.
Yeah.
And the way they did it was right, I think. You know, building up all their heroes and then having them cross over rather than trying to launch them all simultaneously and then make every sense after that. So right. I just think it makes it so that, you know, you actually already care for these characters when you have their separate movies, and then when they bring them all together, you don't have to take time for so many character moments or introducing new characters and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I also wish that we'd gotten that, like, solo Batman movie and a sequel to Man of Steel, mm-hmm. before we really got that, you know, trying to force the shared universe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, there are good MCU movies out there. There's good Deadpool out of the 20th Century Fox Marvel movie. That's still one of my favorites, as a matter of fact. You know, just even that, just having the standalone, I mean, you can kind of cross over just a little bit, but just set up a character first. That way, like you said, we can have feelings towards them. I mean, with this Batman, yeah, we kind of see you really have to pay attention with everything that's going on in Batman v Superman to kind of figure out, okay, well, you know, he was Batman before this. He lost, spoiler alert, the Robin in that version died. Joker is out there, and there's a whole bunch of other elements that are going on there. And now he's killing, and, you know, there's new rules, as Alfred said in there. And, you know, I would have liked to have seen, I don't know, just the original Batman, what drove him to this. But, you know, I can go on talking that about that forever. But I will say that, you know, you don't always have to catch up to the other team so fast. You could have just, you know, spaced it out, and you would have been just fine. Yeah. So, having another a Batman movie sooner, that's where I was going with that. I'm really excited for that. If what's his name? He's the guy, Maginola. I had heard on his social media that, you know, they're going to start filming it after the beginning of the year or right around there. So
that
they're going to have to if they're going to do this right. And I don't know, like, it depends on how much, you know, post production they have with this. But for a Batman movie, I mean, I don't think you have to have too much CGI. But hey, depends on what they want to do with that. So, yeah. All right. So, Christian, I'm going to shift gears here. And this is something I'm actually glad that you're on the show for, because I know that you are a big James Bond fan, right? Slightly.
Oh, yes.
Just slightly. Okay.
Maybe just a little.
So, I don't know if you heard this bit of news drop. So, it's called BBC Radio 4. What they're doing, or what they did, was this documentary. Yeah. And it aired, you know, and it was talking about the author, Ian Fleming. And for those of you that don't know who Ian Fleming is, if you are a Batman fan, he is the creator of James Bond. Or is he? he's obviously, his most famous creation is James Bond, but the host, the presenter of this, and his name is Miles Jupp, he was explaining that James Bond may not have been invented by Ian Fleming, but by a lady novelist with a shock of white hair and the remarkable name of Phyllis Bottome. So, obviously, that's a pretty big thing to say, that all this time that Ian Fleming is not the creator of James Bond. So, let me go a little bit further with this. So, this author, Bottom, she was an author in the early 20th century. She actually, in 1946, she wrote a James Bond book. Here's the kicker. He wasn't called James Bond. Her character's name was called Mark Chalmers. But he has every characteristic of James Bond. So Chalmers, he's the hero of Bottom's novel. He's about 36 years old, dark haired, master at Eton, who was signed up to work for the British intelligence by a friend, Reggie, who works at the Foreign Office. After meeting with B, that's B as in boy, the head of British intelligence, he is dispatched to the Content with a mission to communicate with the British sleeper agent and a suicide pill in case it all goes wrong. Chalmers is a keen aficionado of mountain sports, enthusiastic about the fine food and wine, and has an eye for a pretty girl. He also speaks fluent French and German.
Sounds familiar.
I just literally dropped my martini right about now. All right, let's just go with this. Some ideas are never original. you know, it is hard to create an original idea. I know that Fleming, what I read, I'll tweet out the article again, but that he actually, this, the author Bottom, did inspire Fleming. They were kind of working together and kind of gave him, you know, he kind of, or kind of pushed him to go with something like this. So for this to, I mean, I don't think she's alive, not that I would imagine. But besides the point, though, for this to all of a sudden come out and to say that everything that we know about Ian Fleming, his creation, was kind of, I don't know if you will, I don't want to say the word, like, plagiarized or stolen, but it sure sounds pretty close. What do you think?
Well, so I also read about this, and I read about the I think the article that the presenter had written beforehand,
right?
And it was interesting to me just to read, like, I guess, like, when I read it, it sounded like they were, well, at first I thought they were only acquainted after 1946, but it seems like, you know, the author and her husband actually knew Fleming when he was much younger man, sometime right around like 1916 or something like that. And when I've read all of the original Flemings, and so the fact that, you know, he knew them as when he was younger, and that they taught him to ski, I think was what they said, they taught him
to ski. Yeah, they taught him to ski, yeah, right.
And that just reminds me of the, what's that? The short story Octopussy.
Right.
And which part of this backstory is also in
Spectre.
In Spectre, and also in the movie Octopussy, where, right, you know, someone who Bond was, you know, acquainted with, thank you, as a young man, and taught him to ski, and sort of was acted as like a surrogate family for him.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's basically the character of Oberhauser and his wife.
Exactly.
And it was just, so that caught my eye. And I'm like, yes, some of those things are really on the nose, like, you know, fluent in French and German. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
But there's a key difference in, you know, is a master at Eden as opposed to, and was recruited in the spy agency as opposed to someone who's been in the spy agency, you know, since, what, I think World War II is when, in the official Fleming timeline, is when he joined up.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And, you know, the fact that the boss was named B, was it B as in boy?
Yeah, B as in boy. That's right. Not so, M, but B.
I don't know how commonly known it was at the time that the head of the British Secret Service was actually nicknamed C. I think, I'm trying to remember his actual name was Mansfield Cumming. I'm trying to remember if it was like Peter or whatever the first name was. But yeah, he nicknamed himself C. He would always sign anything with just a green pen with just the letter C. So wow. The fact that he had the head of their secret service in her book was a single letter.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's just a take off the actual head of the secret service rather than being, you know, oh, something that Fleming copied.
Right.
I think there's probably definitely influences from
Absolutely.
This woman that Fleming took, but I don't think it would be a flat out copy is what I like, or plagiarism.
No.
I think, because he also, I'm trying to remember what, he also had other influences that were, if you look back at them, they're very similar as well. I'm trying to remember what they are off the top of my head, but I can't. Mm-hmm. But, so he, you know, when Fleming, and I'm sure you know this already, then, you know, Fleming wrote this basically before he was about to get married. And it was just the way to get all of his, you know, jitters out,
mm-hmm,
and all his worries about getting married. So he just said he was going to sit down and write the ultimate spy novel in Casino Royale.
That's correct.
So yeah, I'm sure he took all sorts of sources to sort of formulate his idea. And maybe there was more influence from, what was this woman's name?
Her name was, it is Phyllis Bottome.
Phyllis Bottome, right? Yeah. So I'm sure that there's definitely some influence from her, but I think like the scenarios that Fleming came up with, like the card game. I mean, that was out of his own experience in right. the war, where he tried to clean out some, I think it was Gestapo agents, and while he, you know, Bond succeeded, but he failed miserably.
Right. Yeah.
So.
Yeah. No, it doesn't, I would say it doesn't bother me at all. Because I know that a lot of, you know, famous, I guess we'll say, you know, characters from novels or even movies, they're all based, they all have very similar, characteristics, if you will. You even want to compare Tony Stark to Bruce Wayne, and there's a lot there.
Yeah, just a little.
there's quite a few there. And you know, I'm thinking of it must be because it's on my mind right now. Like I said, even the creation of Star Wars, the whole Star Wars by George Lucas, he used so many different things for inspiration. And some could say that he took like little bits and pieces from other, you know, movies or novelizations. You know, even looking at a filmmaker like Christopher Nolan, and I'm watching like Interstellar over the weekend, and it's actually a really good movie. If you have
actually haven't seen that yet,
if you have 3 hours to spare and you have to turn your brain on for that, but it's a different type of Christopher Nolan movie, and it's obviously nothing like Dark Knight or even Inception. But you can tell that, you know, that's not that I was reading that he was inspired, and it was kind of like not a tribute, but it was kind of like his inspiration came from a whole bunch of different movies. So for an author, and he's a writer too. So for an author to have inspiration like that, it doesn't bother me. If he just flat out like completely stole everything, like, you know, from this lady Bottome, you know, that would be a totally different thing. And, you know, James Bond is, he looks like he took like some elements and then he put his own spin onto it. So, you know, for that, I just that, you know, obviously this is going to be in the news out more and people are going to probably be criticizing Fleming. And honestly, I don't think, you know, like you said, I don't think there's any reason to. There really isn't at all. Yeah. But yeah, I thought it was worth sharing out there. So, all right, let's move into a couple quick news bits that I have here. I haven't had a chance to get to this, but this is so important that I did want to make sure I touch this, that Christian, hold on for this. Billy Dee Williams will be coming back to voice Two-Face in the Lego Batman movie. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it's, you know, I can't believe I held on so long on that, but yeah, I always thought it was worth noting because he's, as my friend would say, he's mother freaking Lando. And yeah, he is, you know, even watching old school Batman 1989 a couple days ago, I'm like, man, having him, it would have been so great to see him as Two-Face had they decided to move on with that and say, even after Batman Returns. Obviously, he wasn't in that, but because he's so Billy Dee Williams that he's so smooth and as Harvey Dent in Batman 89, that seeing him be the bad guy, we've seen elements of that in other movies before, but I can't, I mean, even though it's just the voice, it's just, at least, you know, for the uber nerds out there, it's like, okay, well, we have somewhat of a chance to see him be Two-Face. So excited about that. There's a Suicide Squad Honest Trailer out there. Now, Christian, are you familiar with Honest Trailers?
Oh, I love them, but I actually haven't seen this one yet, so okay. I'm excited to see that.
I won't spoil it for you, but I will say that it gets pretty messy in there. So for those of us that haven't seen Honest Trailers, it's a really great site. They do videos, and what they do is they take a trailer and they take a movie. So of course, be prepared if you haven't seen the movie. So if they were to take Suicide Squad, what they do is they say, oh, well, here's a movie where we take all the bad guys, but they're not so bad, something like that. And they just kind of, they bash on it overall. They really bash on it. And they do that for a whole bunch of movies. They've done that for Marvel movies. They've done that for even Batman movies. And I think they, I don't know if they ever did one for James Bond. I know they've done everything. I know that there's sites that do everything wrong with James Bond in 10 minutes or
they
less.
They did Spectre, I think. And I think they did Skyfall, too.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't remember if they've done any other ones, but they've done some of the recent ones.
Right. Overall, though, if you can take a joke, it's really fun to watch this kind of stuff because you're like, oh, well, they make some good points. But at the end of the day, it's all about what you think about the movie. So make sure that you check that out. There's a trailer, though, and I definitely wanted to bring this up, especially given that, you know, this is kind of a Star Wars theme week, and there I have more Star Wars theme stuff in here at the bottom of the show. But there is a trailer, and Zack Snyder, if those of you didn't know about this, he was having a lot of fun, obviously because he gets to direct a Batman and Superman film with Wonder Woman in it. But during that time, it was the same time that Star Wars The Force Awakens was being filmed by J.J. Abrams. And the two were, if you remember this, Christian, they were like creating pictures of, you know, Batman elements in a Star Wars movie and Star Wars elements in a Batman movie. So what Snyder did is he did a mashup trailer of Batman v Superman with all these Star Wars elements in it. And I've been posting these all over my Instagram and social media. And I got to tell you have to watch this if you were a fan of both of them. There's all kinds of like nice, really cool little Easter eggs. There's X-Wings, there's Darth Vader, there's Yoda in there, there's all kind, there's even R2-D2 somehow, they managed to do that. And there's lightsabers galore, so if you are a fan of these two, I implore you to go check this out because it is hilarious. So, all right, Christian, the reason we had you on the show today is because you wanted to talk about, and I must say that I was, when I saw this, I was like, I need to get out there. You went on a tour at the WB Warner Brothers Studios, and is where exactly in California is that? Is that Hollywood?
Burbank.
Burbank, California. Okay, there you go. And I saw, just judging by these pictures, and if you don't mind, if I can put these out on social media.
Oh, go for it, yeah.
Because you got, I'm going to, actually, you know what, I'm going to let you take it from here. And how did you, was this trip planned?
So, basically, for the last few years, me and my mom and sister, we always do Thanksgivings, like traveling. So we're always traveling somewhere. So like, you know, I think last year we were in Boston. A year before that, we were in Quebec. And this year we said, oh, you know, let's go to Disneyland. And so we're in Anaheim, and we're trying to figure out other things we wanted to do. So we went to Disneyland for a few days. We also did, you know, Universal Studios, Harry Potter there. And on the last day, we were looking for something to do. I was like, wait a minute. And I saw a bunch of my friends posting photos, they all were in LA, and they'd be tagging themselves at Central Perk, which, ooh, if you don't know, was the coffee shop in France. So I looked at, where are they doing this? And I saw that Warner Brothers has a studio tour. And as I looked into it more, I was like, all right, what else do they have? Oh, they have a whole thing on Suicide Squad, Batman v Superman, and the Batmobile. So I was like, all right, I need to go there.
Like yesterday. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah. So it was, yeah, it was a we just ended up doing that for one day. And I think it's about a three-hour tour or so. And then there's a part of it where you can, you know, walk by yourself and you can take as long as you want in certain parts. So it was really cool. So I don't think I have any good photos of that, but so not only do you get to see, you know, what, you know, some of the sound stages where they would film stuff, like we also went to see the set of The Big Bang Theory.
Nice.
Which was like, actually, it's always interesting to see film sets, because, or especially TV sets, because they're a lot smaller than you think they are.
Oh,
I bet. Have this, they're built so that it looks a lot bigger, but actually tiny. But so not only that, we got to see the studio backlot, which was, they have various sections of it, including one that's like near New York Street, one that's their sort of suburbia section. And I found out, so various parts have been used in Batman movies. So like they call it the City Hall section of the New York Street, was actually used in the 1966 Batman TV show. And that was sitting there, City Hall, or the police, I think, yeah, the police station, where they'd be running up there every week to meet with Commissioner Gordon and Chief O'Hara.
Nice.
So that was really neat. And then also, apparently, the parts of the New York Street were used in, you know, a movie I know that's dear to your heart, Batman Returns.
Yeah.
And so they've, like, a lot of those streets were Gotham City.
Oh, okay.
So I got to see that. And so I got toured around the back lot. There's other movies that were filmed in various, there, I think, I'm trying to remember, if, I think part of Batman and Robin also was actually placed there too, but let's not talk about that movie.
We can talk about, I mean, no, it's okay. Yeah. I mean, like I said, yeah, it has a few redeeming qualities in it, but it's there.
Yeah. But yeah, so, and then the next part that I was really cool to me was they took us into what they call the vault, which is where they have a lot of stuff for their either recent or upcoming movies. And so currently at the vault, they have a lot of costumes from Batman v Superman and lots of stuff from Suicide Squad. So like just going down a list. Well, first of all, once you get in there, it's like all DC Comics themes. So you have these like giant banners of the Justice League, all members of the Justice League. And under each banner, for each character, you have a very famous comic book for each one of them. So for Batman, you have the Batman number one, which is the first appearance of the Joker. For the Flash, you have like the Flash of Two Worlds. I don't remember what number off the top of my head, which is where Barry Allen Flash meets Jay Garrick Flash. And Superman is Superman number one. I'm trying to remember what's actually, I think that's the first appearance of Lex Luthor there. But you also have, you know, a full-size Superman costume. You have Wonder Woman, Batman. You've got Batman's outfit from the Nightmare. You have a chunk of kryptonite, like, that's as featured in Batman v Superman. You've got the Wayne Crypt. And one of the interesting things was you've got the suit, the Robin suit that was displayed in the Batcave.
Yes, I wanted to talk about that. Yeah, because it's so not what you even mentioned it. It's not what we thought it was.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to have to rewatch the movie, but when they show it on display, you know, it looks exactly like it is in the movie, but it's actually got the short pants that Dick Grayson had. I was like, wait a minute. I didn't even catch that in the movie.
Me
so
neither.
Maybe it's entirely possible that they just, you know, only put, for some reason, didn't put the rest of the pants on display, but it just looks like it's the authentic, like, pretty much the authentic Robin costume with the short pants. I was like, and they, like, the colors are really, like, sort of muted, but they are the actual, you know, the red and green.
Okay.
Like, that's really interesting.
Yeah, it was always hard to tell. They have it, the look on display is exactly how it is in the movie, but I guess I'm so busy reading haha jokes on you, Batman, that I never paid attention to the shorts. And,
right.
And the colors, and you said it there is red in there because I know the lighting in general.
In
the movie, it's tough to see. Yeah.
My theory is the reason it looks like that is because that costume was in an explosion.
Oh, good. Interesting.
Because, I mean, that's how Jason Todd was killed in the comics. Well, there was a crowbar first, and then there was an explosion, which somehow he survives long enough after that to at least, you know, die in Bruce's arms. But, but yeah, so there was that. There's also, so that's most of the Batman v Superman section. There's also the costumes from the Daily Planet, so Clark Kent, Lois Lane, Perry White. And then you get on to the Suicide Squad costumes. They have basically every single character's costume, including Katana, Deadshot, Captain Boomerang. I think they had Killer Croc's hoodie, but not the actual, like, prosthetics he wore. And then, you have your Harley Quinn outfit and your Joker outfit. For the Joker, they took the white tuxedo jacket and bow tie that he had for that one. And then you also have some props like Batman's grapple gun, which I thought was interesting to me, that it looks not too dissimilar from the Batman Begins one, actually.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, it's like, in terms of shape, it's relatively similar, but I think, like, details are different, but it's like, it's got sort of the same feel, which is interesting to me. But yeah, so that was the vault. And then we did a couple other stops, including some sound stages for, I think we saw the Ellen set. But the next big, really cool thing for me was, basically their garage, which has all of the Batmobiles.
Yes.
I think they're missing one. It's the one from Batman and Robin. Which I'm like, you know, that's okay that it's not there, but they had
Mr. Freeze's. It's an Arnold Schwarzenegger's garage, is his mansion.
They've got the Batman 89 / Batman Returns one Batmobile. They've got the Batman Forever Batmobile, the one which goes up a wall.
Yeah.
They've got, from Batman and Robin, they do have the Bat Hammer, which is his ice vehicle. And they've got Batgirl's Batcycle, and they've got Robin's motorcycle, the Redbird, which is, well, in my memory, will always be, oh yes, in the beginning of the movie, when he crashes into the museum through doors, and yet somehow makes a perfect Robin symbol when he crashes through those doors.
Oh my god, I have to go back and watch that now, just for that.
It's like, I've watched that movie more than I would like to admit, but it's always it's always just because I just want to laugh.
Yeah,
like,
I always said it makes a great comedy. Yeah.
But it's like me and my sister, actually around this time of year, because of the winter, there's a lot of ice puns made.
Oh.
Or any time that, you know, that there's going to be a storm, I would just text my sister and say, a freeze is coming.
That was great.
So, yeah, so they've got that. They've got a bunch of props from Batman and Robin as well.
Okay.
And they've got the Catwoman suit from Batman Returns.
Ooh.
They've got, and then they have it all it's interesting. They have it just sort of posed sort of seductively, like on a mannequin, like laying down on the, like inside a glass box. Like, that's a little, that's an interesting way to do that.
Oh, kind of like how she was when she laid on Penguin's bed. Oh, wow.
Yeah, basically.
Okay.
And then you've got, the bomb from Batman, or not, The Dark Knight Rises.
Yeah.
I don't know if, I'm trying to remember if I made this joke to you.
Yeah.
But I've always thought that the one way that movie could have been better is if at the end, Christian Bale's Batman says, "Some days, you just can't get rid of a bomb." In the homage to the 1966 Batman movie.
You know, I've never, ever watched the 1966 really? Batman movie. That is, we'll just say 2017 is right around the corner, and there will be, we might be going back to the vault of Batman. So I'll leave that as a tease there, but
all right.
I like that joke though.
It'll make even more sense once you've seen that movie.
Okay, all right, yeah.
So they've got the two tumblers actually. That's the original tumbler that's featured in Batman Begins and the Dark Knight, and they've got one of the prototype tumblers that Bane got in possession in Dark Knight Return or Dark Knight Rises.
Yep.
So it's got camo on it still, and then you've got the Batpod,
yeah,
which was really cool, and I've got a story about that later too. And then you've got the Batsignal, which looks like the one from the Dark Knight trilogy.
Yeah,
and in the middle of the room, middle of all of this, you've got the Batman statue from the Dark Knight Rises that was installed in police headquarters or wherever it was supposed to be.
It looks great. Yeah, I'm looking at it now,
and it's just so cool just to see that done. It's like it's giant.
I was gonna say, how big is this? Because I mean, I see a guy in the background, he looks pretty tall. I would say this is what, 8 feet tall, maybe?
At least 8 feet tall. Maybe 10 feet actually. Yeah.
I don't think I could ever talk my wife into putting that even in, not even if it was in my office, but if I could put that in my front yard.
I was thinking about that. I just have a front, like put it like in the middle of a fountain, just sort of
imagine how many people you would scare when they're walking their dogs or just walking to their car in the morning.
Middle of the night and they see, that would be hilarious. Actually,
and then you just put a recording of the Batman voice on there. Where are you going? Oh, we're such nerds. Oh well, it's worth it. Yep. Oh, that is cool though. I mean, that's really cool. Yeah.
And then after the vault,
this is the garage, right?
Okay. You get to go through. We went through a few more sound stages, and like including the massive prop room. I was looking for anything that could have been in a Batman movie, but I didn't see anything.
Mm-hmm.
They take you to what's called Studio 48, which is like really. It's not actually a studio, but it's more of a, you know, see how these things were made. So they take you through the whole process of script writing or screenwriting, casting, set design, costume design. And so in the costume design, we got to see a few Kryptonian costumes from Man of Steel.
Nice. Did you see the black one?
What's that?
Was the black one in there?
not that I saw.
Ah.
That would be cool, though.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it was Superman's suit and then his dad, Jor-El's suit. And I think, what's her name? Feyara?
Yes.
Feyara's suit from the Man of Steel.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got to do something which was really fun, which was get on top of a replica of the Batpod. And they put a cape on me as well, and I got to take some photos and a little video where I'm like acting out a chase from, I think it's from The Dark Knight, when he's, you know, underground and lower, that area where they filmed in Chicago of Lower Wacker Drive, where he's fighting off the Joker. So I got to do that. I got some good photos. And it just so happened I was wearing, well, first of all, I was wearing
the leather jacket.
Well, I was wearing a shirt which is, looks like a tuxedo shirt, and it's open, like it's printed on it, it's a t-shirt, but it's a tuxedo shirt that's opened up to reveal a Batman suit underneath that. But then I was also wearing a leather jacket over that, so I zipped up the leather jacket, and it looks actually really good underneath.
I was going to say, it works. It works. It really does.
Yeah.
Love it.
So I get to do that, and my sister actually, so because it's Warner Brothers. They also had a bunch of Harry Potter stuff there. So she got she did the broomstick ride from Harry Potter, which is
very nice.
Seemed like a lot of fun too. And there was also one of the Batman or Dark Knight Rises suits was in that area too, and that was really cool.
Nice.
But yeah, it was just like, I think the highlight for me was really just the vehicle, just seeing them up close and personal. Mm-hmm. And of course, I'm making all sorts of jokes. Like when I saw the camo tumbler, I asked my sister, does it come in black?
You and I have talked about this before. It's just the quotes, trying to fit in a Batman or James Bond quote. It's not as easy to fit a Batman quote in. So of all times for you to fit in Batman quotes, you had to have been given like the green light to do it right here and then.
Oh, yes. Yes. Yeah, it was just, I mean, like just seeing up close. Like, I don't like, for me, the Batman v Superman Batmobile, it's not my favorite because it doesn't look that, well, it looks like it's sort of in between the Tumbler and the 89 Batmobile, but it's not as distinctive as I would like.
Yeah. It's like a mashup in a way, I would say.
But seeing all the details for that was really cool because I really haven't like paid that close attention to it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, seeing that 89 Batmobile, it's like, that's just so cool because the cockpit's open so you can see into it and see all the various dials and buttons. And, So it was just all around awesome. Like, the only thing was that no one else on my tour seemed to be as excited about Batman stuff as like me or my sister was. Aww. So our tour guide would sometimes rush us a little bit through the Batman. Wait, no, I want to see this.
Yeah. Come on, it's Batman. It's Batman stuff.
See, I'm here for this.
Exactly. You paid your money to go see all this. Yeah. It seems like they didn't give you any problems about taking as many pictures as you wanted.
No. So for this stuff, these are in areas where, like, you know, you could take as many photos as you wanted. There are areas like, say, the Big Bang Theory or the Ellen sets where, because they're active sets, you can't take any photos. We also walked onto the set of the new Lethal Weapon TV show that they have going on. So we got to see their, like, LAPD headquarters, which was really coolly designed, but I can't take any photos of it. So
I see. No problem.
So it's anywhere there's active filming going on, you can't take photos, but everything else, and they told us you should take as many photos as you want. So I got as many as I could.
That's great. I would be, you know, I'd be taking pictures. I'd be asking, you know, to take pictures in front of everything. And then I would just stare like a little kid on Christmas Day, just staring at his Christmas gift. I mean, I'm doing that right now to like even the 89 Batman Returns Batmobile. How big is that car?
It is huge. Yeah. Like, I don't know how to describe how long it is. Just like going up to it and just like staring down. It's like, how did they maneuver this thing?
Right, well, you couldn't.
We know how he corners.
Well, yeah. grappling
he
hook.
He has a little grappling hook that
leads
him around a corner. But still, I don't know how you maneuver that thing.
So the Tumbler's got to be what, like a quarter the size of the Batman Returns Batmobile, right?
It's not smaller. As long as it is, but it is like more massive in terms, like taller.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've seen. Go ahead. I was gonna say.
So it's taller, and it's sort of just like it's built like a tank.
Oh yeah, it is a tank. Absolutely. Yeah, and I remember it was back in 2012. And I think I've talked about this. The Dark Knight Rises, when they were doing their Tumbler tour, and I got a chance to see the Tumbler, and I'm just like going downtown, and all of a sudden I'm stopped at a red light. I see this tractor trailer drive by, and what's on it is a black Tumbler from the Dark Knight or Batman Begins and the Dark Knight, and just going, just as if it's just going. And I'm like, that's the Batmobile. And then because I was going to actually see it that day, and then it turns out that they had the Batpod there also, and you couldn't get on any of these. So when I saw your pictures of you getting on the Batpod, I mean, I would be I've said before, I would be so giddy right there. That's awesome, man. So I guess you would recommend that tour.
Oh, I would. I mean, if you're even if you're not a Batman fan, there's always a lot, like, if you're just a fan of movies in general, there's a lot of great things to see there. Like, one of the other things I saw, like, I'm a Harry Potter fan, and so Lord of the Rings, well, I am a Harry Potter fan, but I'm also a Lord of the Rings fan, and it's one of the things they had in that area was showing you how they do, like, force perspective stuff to make, you know, they did this in that movie, too, to make Gandalf larger than the hobbits.
Ah, okay.
So yeah, so if you're just a fan of movies in general, go there. But if you're a Batman fan, at least right now, they have a lot of Batman stuff. And they'll probably have more stuff as Justice League and the Wonder Woman and hopefully the solo Batman movie soon come out.
Yeah, definitely. More Batman suits and whatever else out there. Yeah. And Batman's got to have a few new toys in there, too. At least I hope he does. Yeah. So, well, that's awesome, man. That's great. I'm real happy for you. So maybe one day I'll make it out there. I think it's probably easier to make it to the WB tour than it is to, say, where is the James Bond Museum? I know that actually in Dubai they're having they're having that thing there. They're having like all the
then they have the vehicles of James Bond in London at the moment.
Yeah. Not as easy to get to London for me these days as it used to be. So all right. Well, that's badass, man. So all right, let's move on here and time to talk some birthdays. You know, this is actually the last regular show of the season or of the year because I'm doing my 2016 year in review. Might be broken off into two parts. Depends on how much information I have to cover in one episode. We'll see. But this is the last of the birthdays for the year this year, Christian. So here we go. Lynn Holly Johnson celebrates a birthday on December 13th. Do you remember where she was from? What movie?
I do not, actually.
She played BB Doll in For Your Eyes Only.
Oh.
Now, bonus points if you can remember the quotes that James Bond said to her when she snuck into his bedroom at the hotel.
Let's see.
Anything.
I'm trying to... Well, I remember she said something... Oh, yes, and you know, that's silly. Builds muscle tone.
I don't think your Uncle Harry would approve. That's a laugh. He still thinks I'm a virgin. I'm like, oh my God. Oh. But what I loved about the character is they played it so well because they were aware that Roger Moore was getting older. And instead of just, you know, saying, oh yeah, absolutely, I'm just going to jump in bed. No, it's just, okay, she's younger and let's roll with this. And it was a great spin that they did with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Always for that, I will love that character of her. And she was really funny. She brought kind of that comic relief in a way, too, as she was trying to flirt with all the henchmen in there. I forget his name. Kriegler. Yeah. When she was trying, Eric, I'll meet you for drinks at the end of the finish line. And he would just go away as fast as he could ski away. It was pretty funny. All right. Vijay Armitage. He celebrates a birthday on December 14th. He played Vijay in Octopussy. Yeah, he got to keep his name in there. Pretty cool. Yeah, one of the highlights of Octopussy is Vijay. I think he's really, really good in that. So for those of you that haven't seen it, Vijay is one of his contacts in, oh my God, it was in India. No, it wasn't in India. Yeah, I thought there was a specific part. I don't remember if they said that, but anyway, he was a contact in India, but, you know, James Bond started to have the influence on him, but I think the funniest thing about that is when they're in this like little, it's not a scooter chase, but it's like some kind of a cart chase that they're having in downtown. And Vijay takes out his tennis racket and he's playing a little tennis match and the crowd is looking at one side. Then they're looking at the other side and so forth. And then he puts the tennis racket through the guy's head. And it was really, really funny. And of course, when they're in Q Slab with James Bond in there and Bond's like, oh, hey, Q, problems keeping it up? And Vijay's just kind of laughing at all his jokes and Q's like, don't let him influence you. So good stuff there. All right. Miriam Diabo, I think that's how you say her last name, celebrates a birthday on December 27th. She played Cara Millevoy in The Living Daylights. Remember her?
Oh, yes. She's actually one of my favorite Bond girls. I like her in that movie, and I just like that scene where, you know, they're crossing the border in the cello case, and, you know, it says, flash this. We have nothing to declare except the cello.
Yes. Good stuff. Yeah, I think near the end of the movie, she's so mad at James Bond and, she's, you know, she calls him something and then he's like, are you trying to say I'm a horse's ass? Love that part. Yeah. So yeah, happy birthday to her. Barbara Carrera, you might not know this name, but she celebrated a birthday on December 31st. She played well, I never mentioned this movie too much, Fatima Blush in Never Say Never Again. Now, part of my 2017 things is revisiting some stuff that, you know, I haven't had a chance to talk about. And maybe, I will talk about Never Say Never Again a little bit more come the 2017 season. We'll see. Were you a fan of that movie?
So I'm going to admit something that here, that sure. That's actually the first Bond movie I really saw.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, like, I don't remember much of it, but I remember seeing, like, for some reason, I remember when she dies, actually, and, yeah. You know, the pen that, you know, shoots her and explodes.
Yes.
And all that's left is her, like, shoes. So, like, I remember, I think I saw it on TV, and I was like, I really didn't, like, I was vaguely aware what James Bond was, but I didn't really know what was going on. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until much later when I, like, actually watched all of the Bond films, and then I rewatched, like, oh, that's exactly the same plot as Thunderball. That's interesting.
Yep, from the same writer. That's right. Yep. Yep, almost identical.
But, yeah. So I've got some sort of a soft spot for that movie, and I think, you know, yes, it's the exact same movie, but I like Sean Connery in it. He, you know, and I like the, you know, they're sort of long before, you know, Skyfall did it. You know, they're playing off, you know, the older Bond who thinks he might be played out, but no, he comes back into action.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and a new M in there, a Black Felix Slater.
Yeah.
They had a motorcycle in their chase that was really cool. And I always think about that motorcycle chase from the James Bond video game, Everything or Nothing, with Pierce Brosnan in there, which kind of did some similar tricks on there.
Interesting.
Yeah, we'll talk Bond video games next year too. But no, overall, it's a fun movie, and it's, you know, it has nothing related to a James Bond theme in there at all.
Yeah.
But, so if people want to continue to criticize the Eric Serra score, and even though it's an unofficial Bond, I would say that would be probably the worst James Bond score. But hey, and so yeah. Anyway, the final birthday here is Mr. Val Kilmer, and he celebrates a birthday on December 31st. So, yeah, what, I mean, we've all, I put polls online to see, you know, what people thought of Val Kilmer, and not many people have negative things to say about Val Kilmer. I mean, he's not their favorite, but he's not their least favorite. And, you know, I think that the approach that they did in Batman Forever with him of, when they had the flashbacks, if you will, to when he was going back to the wake of his parents and how he was able to play that emotional side, I really dig that. As a matter of fact, I think he did really well with that. You know, how he was dealing with, you know, do I want to be Batman anymore? I think that, you know, it just, I don't know if Keaton, I think Keaton could have done it, but, you know, it seems like Kilmer was kind of like a filler in a way, or I guess it was kind of thrown in there, and he was, I don't know if he was a big a fan, and yeah, you never really hear him do any press or really talk about it at all either. What do you
think? Yeah, I mean, I don't think anyone really asks him about it, but more as a pity, because I liked him as Batman, and I think this, you know, that you mentioned that whole storyline about, you know, the flashbacks in the book, and apparently there's a whole, like, I don't know if they ever released it, or if they ever, but maybe they talked about it in, like, a director's commentary, but there's a whole, like, part of that got cut out of the movie where, like, you know, after he gets shot in the head or grazed by Two-Face,
yeah,
he actually loses his memory and forgets that he's Batman. He remembers he's Bruce Wayne. Really? And there's a whole subplot about him, you know, trying to go through that, you know, through the notebook. And there's also some sort of absolution for him, like, you know, because this whole time he's blaming himself because he thinks he's the one who wanted to see Mask of Zorro that night and take them out. And then he finds that his father had written it, you know, that he, you know, he was going to take them out to the family out to there and, you know, bring them to that movie.
Mm-hmm.
And so it sort of like absolves him of that, some of the guilt he had that he was blaming himself for his parents' murder.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's not going to make him stop being Batman because, you know, they still died and, you know, he still need to be avenged,
mm-hmm,
and Gotham City protected. But it, you know, there was that thread that allowed him to, you know, say, you know, it tied into, you know, where he says, you know, I'm both Bruce Wayne and not Batman, not because I have to be, but because I choose to be.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. The elements that were there, had it been done on a darker tone, I think it would have worked better. Mm-hmm. But yeah. I don't blame Val Kilmer at all with that. I think that, you know, I think the thing that gets me every time is the Batman smile or the Batman grin. That gets me every time. That's if he's ever famous for anything, it's always going to be the meme of him with the Batman grin. But no, I still dig it. So yeah. All right. Anniversary. The last anniversary this year is going to be Tomorrow Never Dies, and that celebrates an anniversary on December 19th. So, you know, I watched it over the Thanksgiving, and it's on still occasionally on the movie channels, and, I still like it. And I think that, it'll hold up. And it, to me, it would be the Spy Who Loved Me, or it would be the You Only Live Twice version of what Pierce Brosnan was given, because you have two countries going against each other. In this case, it is England versus China. And you know, you have this guy in between who's trying to cause a war, but this, the reason for this is because, you know, he wants ratings for his news channel, and he's practically Ted Turner. But it's a fun James Bond movie. It's really fun, and it's where Pierce started to show that more of a lighter side. If he was at his darkest in Goldeneye, this would be more fun in a way when it comes to Tomorrow Never Dies. What are your thoughts on it?
Oh, see, for like I said, I came to the actual Bond movies later in life than like around the time I was 16, and for a long time that was one of my favorites, just because I liked the action in it, and I just liked, you know, Brosnan sort of being out of sorts when he was in Vietnam, and
yes,
you know, in Michelle Yeoh's character's like lair with all the gadgets in there. So I enjoyed it, and I thought, you know, it was a lot of fun. And you're right, there's a lot of that You Only Live Twice or Spy Who Loved Me sort of themes in there, and I think, you know, it'll come around, like people come around on it too, just because it's like it got interesting ideas about, you know, the media and its role in how, you know, politics happens, which I'm going to say might be a little relevant in the next few years.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. No, it's, I think it's one that's going to hold up even better than some of the other Bond movies in that fact. And even something down to the cinematography of it, I think that cinematography was, or it's brighter, not as filmed. It almost seems like Goldeneye, if there was ever anything I'd say about Goldeneye, is that how it's filmed, it looks like it's aged a little bit more, I think, in that fact. Tomorrow Never Dies looks like it was only made just recently. But yeah, overall, great Bond movie. If you're a fan of James Bond, or if you're a fan of Batman, I think you would definitely enjoy it. Some really good car sequences, or car chases, bike chases.
Yes.
the gadget scene that you mentioned in there, it's a great, it's like going into Q Labs, but not. But he still has fun with it at the same time, so. Yeah. All right. So let's move into the final segment of the show. It is Versus. It needs no introduction, but I'll give it anyway. We compare movies of the Bond, James Bond, that is, and Batman franchises versus others in the same wheelhouse, sometimes totally different. This week, I went to a galaxy far, far away, which I've done the last 2 weeks. I'm going to do it again, but I will refresh your memory. Last week's Versus was The Dark Knight versus The Empire Strikes Back. And let me tell you that The Dark Knight ended up winning.
Wow.
The Dark Knight ended up winning. It's probably because there are Batman fans out here. That would be my only guess. But I will say that I was kind of shocked. But I'm like, you know, that it maybe because The Empire Strikes Back has been out longer, I'm thinking, oh, well, you know, that's going to be the one, you know. And boy, was I wrong. I really was. And I'm not upset about it at all. Dark Knight won 85% to 15% for Empire Strikes Back.
Wow.
Yeah. And I'll be sure to post these results. But what do you think? Because I know that you are a fan of both of these franchises.
I mean, see, it's a really tough call because they're both, like, I would say, you know, of their respective trilogies, they are, well, both, they're both the middle entry, and they're also both the best entry.
Yes.
And they're both dealing with, you know, a lot of themes about, you know, what, you know, personal, you know, they've got that grand scale, but they take it down to a personal level of, you know, you've got the relationships between, say, you know, Luke and Vader and all of that going on. And same time, on the other hand, you have, you know, the, in, you know, just the intricacies of the Joker and his scheme. So it's a tough call. I would probably give it, actually, you know what?
You can't go wrong. That's the thing. You really can't go wrong.
I might give it to Dark Knight just because in its way, it can act as a standalone movie.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you really don't need to know too much about Batman Begins to watch The Dark Knight.
No.
Whereas Empire Strikes Back, it is essential that you watch Star Wars before that. Otherwise, you have no idea what's going on.
Exactly.
That's the minor edge I give it.
Yeah, I would say, and I'll kind of go with what you were saying about just the characters, like with, say, Bruce Wayne and comparing Luke Skywalker. Now, it's probably hasn't been done too many times, but we'll do it here because we can. But it's all right. Luke Skywalker, if everybody remembers The Empire Strikes Back, he was forced with the choice of, you know, staying, you know, on turning to the dark side. He was trying not to. Then you have Bruce Wayne, Batman, and he's trying not to break his only rule. What is his only rule? Well, not to kill anybody. And they're slightly similar in a way. It's a time where, and I mentioned this last week, that the villains, this is more about the villains. It really, truly is. We're seeing them come, you know, they're the winners at the end of the day in both these movies. They really are. Spoiler alert there, if you want to call it. These movies been out for quite a while now. But, you know, and they're not happy endings. They're not happy endings at all, but they leave you on a good enough cliffhanger that it's like, wow, I want more. You want more at the end of each of these movies. They make you think, and there's some really good surprises in both these movies. At least I think there is. So, yeah, like I said, you can't go wrong with whichever one you pick. I would still pick The Dark Knight, mainly because I'm a Batman fan and because of the Joker. Just the scene, I'll keep going back to this, that interrogation scene, that is the selling point of that movie. No action, just dialogue, and just these two actors going at it. Literally Christian Bale punching the hell out of Heath Ledger like he asked him to. So I don't think you would ever see Luke Skywalker take a lightsaber to Darth Vader, but that's just me. So this week's verses, it might be a little bit easier, but these are... If those were the two best two of those franchises, then these might be the weaker of the two, some would say.
Oh, boy.
The Dark Knight Rises versus Return of the Jedi. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So it's not so bad. No, I'm not going to put the prequels in there. You were thinking
I thought you were going to say Batman and Robin versus Phantom Menace is what I thought you were going to do.
Even I'm not that. Even to a guy like me, that's cold. Yeah, I couldn't do that. Yeah. No, but I was while I've watched the prequels over this past weekend, I will say that, you know, I was watching Return of the Jedi. I'm like, you know, Return of the Jedi does kind of bring back all the original elements of A New Hope. As does Dark Knight Rises with Batman Begins. It ties it all together. And the question I'm going to leave everybody with is, what ties it up better? Which one is the better of the trilogy? So, it is hard to tie up a trilogy. I mean, not many franchises are able to. But I think that it's safe to say that these are probably the two of the best that are out there, or at least the top five of trilogies that are out there. So I will post it on social media. Have at it. I'm not going to tell you what I pick, even though you might know what I will pick. I'm still not going to say it. Christian, make sure that you vote. The Twitter poll will be open. I'll extend it for a couple days out there because I know everybody's having their holiday parties right about now and getting ready to do that traveling. So... that about wraps it up for this episode of the Batman versus James Bond show. Please subscribe on iTunes and Spreaker, rate it 5 stars, leave a nice little review for me on there. The biggest thing I can ask anybody, your Christmas present, your holiday present to me, is to share the show. That's all I ask. Just share the show with your friends, share with the family, go to somebody else's computer, go to your relative's computer, type in batmanversusbond.com, leave it up there, and just leave them scratching their heads and they'll check it out. Follow me on all the various social media networks, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at batmanversusbond. Find the show at batmanversusbond.com, batmanversusbond.com, and the BS Podcast Network, bspodcastnetwork.com. Christian, it's always a pleasure having you on here. We need to get you back on here next year, which is actually only a couple weeks away, believe it or not. But we need to get you back on here. And we got some Comic-Cons to check out next year too, buddy.
Oh,
yeah, I want to start planning that out. I mean, I know I want to do New York, of course, but I think I want to check out the New Jersey kind of, you know, because they're having the 89 Batmobile up there.
Ooh.
Yeah, just announced. Yeah. So always a pleasure having you. Have a great holiday, buddy.
Having me on? Yeah. Yep. Have happy holidays and happy new year as well.
And to you as well, sir. Oh, and a quick plug here. Next week, or actually the next couple weeks, I will be doing my 2016 year in review. Might be two-part episode, but make sure that you check that out. Stay tuned for more details. Like James Bond, I will return. Until next time, I'm Brian Thomas. Thanks, everybody, for listening, and have a great week. Bye-bye.
The preceding podcast is part of the BS Podcast Network. Visit bspodcastnetwork.com for more shows just like this one, and perhaps a few that are just a little bit better.